this hour, I want to be blessed. This moment, I want to be touched by the Lord. Thank you, Lord. We are grateful. We are humble as we approach the throne of grace at this time. Asking you, Lord, that you touch everyone in Jesus' name. I'm asking you for the move of your spirit upon us in Jesus' name. I pray that the word we are going to hear will benefit us in Jesus' name. Remove every doubt in our lives. Sanctify your people by your truth. By your truth alone. And get us prepared. Ready for your own use. And at the end of the race that you take us home, we give you praise. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Now let's have a seat. We thank God. God is a good God.
Yes.
Thank you for loving us so much. My wife, God bless you. I'm proud to be your husband.
Amen.
And the Bible says, until death, because when we get to that stage, it's you and your God, and me and my God. And that is why today I've been talking about preparing for eternity. Preparing for eternity. It's bothering me this day how young people understand what we call salvation, Christianity, because their explanation about it is quite different for when I was born again. In those days, it is not something shameful for you to cry your heart out and weep after you hear messages. Because there is no camera like this that parades your salvation. It is due to the conviction that you truly examine your life based on the message. You see the ugliness, you see the fittiness, you know that you can't make it without God. And you just go and weep and surrender yourself to the love of God. But today, things are not the same. Things are not the same. Even the gospel preachers, most people right now are, you know, kind of finding a new way, a new approach, modernizing it. But I want to say to you, heaven and earth shall pass away, but not an iota of the word of God will pass away.
Amen.
You cannot change the standard of the kingdom. Based on this, we are going to examine ourselves. Are we preparing for the home above? Are you preparing for your future? When I say are you preparing, I mean preparing according to the standard. We are not going to use religions to camouflage ourselves. It will not work. Because on that day, everything will be exposed. Nothing is secret that will not come to the open. How you live your life, how I live my life, we are to give account. Unfortunately, many people are poorly prepared. And Jesus said, many are called, but few are always found. About 2,000 years ago, Jesus gave a parable about a very dedicated farmer. Talking about working, he was a worker. Serious, committed. And at a particular year, the land yielded so much for him. He was so blessed. He has no time for God. So that means you can be in this world and hold on to it. whatever the world can give to you, and that's what you want. But the tragedy for this man is that they lied you so much, and as he sat down and said, I will pull down my bar, build another, I will say to my soul, the soul don't need your crops, your soul need God. It's the treasure of your life that you must not lose. He made a mistake, he said, I will say unto my soul, sit down, enjoy for many years. And that night the Lord said, thou fool, thy soul will be required of you. And to whom shall all these things be that you stock up? Turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 6. I'm looking at it from verse 19 through verse 20 at this time. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doeth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doeth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. When we look at this, there is something we need to differentiate. Jesus talked about treasure on earth and the treasure in heaven. Now before I go on, I know most of us, by the grace of God, we are born again. We've been, you know, we love the Lord. But when we're talking about eternity, the difference between eternity and here is so, you cannot even put it into words. Eternity is never ending, continuous, infinitely. Here, whatever you have, it will end. Whatever you stack up, it will end. And treasures here cannot be compared with the treasures in heaven. When you say have treasures here, what do you have? What do you have that measure up to your soul? What shall be the profit of a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? May have all the banks, may have the Wall Street. Treasures on earth. Stack it up. None of this is needed in heaven. It is, you want to better your life here. You want to live, you know, make it better. Okay. God can bless you with all those things. He has pleasure in blessing his own people. But what he died for is not for you to pile up treasures on earth. Treasures that he died for is really you, your soul. And when we call you and say, come and accept Jesus Christ, we say, come and accept it into your heart. That is it. It's the most valuable thing, more than the riches in the world. You can't miss that, you can't lose it. And if you don't value that, it means you don't value your life. Jesus knew, you know, your life worth more than all those things. That's why he came down. I have come to seek and to save them that are lost. Don't give yourself to those things. You are not created to work and die. You are not created to make money, pile it up, ride good car. Those things are good. You know, don't misunderstand me. They are good. But that cannot survive when it comes to your life, giving your life to God. And the error that people are making is that some think you are not born again if you are not riding a good car. You don't have enough faith. You don't have the mansion here. You don't have enough faith. Jesus was not preaching that kind of gospel because that is unnecessary. God can bless all believers as much as he blessed believers. But your soul must not be lost. And that is why we are here. We want to prepare, and the Lord will get us prepared in Jesus' name. Amen. But some, you know, when you look at Solomon, as rich as he was, powerful, And he said, you know, at the end, he joined life, he did everything. He said, vanity upon vanity. All is vanity. That was his assessment. So nothing should distract us. We want to make effort. Nothing should distract you. Your life is more than those things. Heaven should be on your mind. Heaven should be on your mind, day and night. So I have 3 points. The first one I want to talk about, the promise of Christ's return. The second is preparation for Christ's return. The third will be permanent rest for believers in Christ. Let's talk about promise for Christ's return. Now that we know that the scripture clearly tells us that lay not up treasures for yourself on earth, because it's not guaranteed. It will not last long. It will not save you. You will have nothing to show for your labor if you think that's what your life worth. You are created in the image of God and you should serve Him. To live a godless life will mean that you have labored in vain. And it is my prayer that none of us will labor in vain, in Jesus' name. In the book of Hebrews, he said, it is appointed as it is appointed unto man, Hebrews 9:27. Once to die after this judgment, appointed. Once to die after this judgment, everything stops. Go to the burial ground, you see those who have gone. They don't have all this treasure going with them. Their cars, their houses, doubtful. Your soul will be required from you. You are not rich towards God. This promise that we are going to read should make you be rich towards God. You need to channel your effort and prepare your life for that which matters, and which is your soul answering to God in the last day, so you can be part of the saints of God to reign with Him. And the Lord will help us to reign with Him in Jesus' name. Amen. We are looking at the book of John chapter 14. Looking at it from verse 1, I will read a couple of verses. John chapter 14. Looking at it from verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I come back and I will take you to myself. That is verse 4. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I love the Lord. I love the Lord. You should love Him. You should love Him. He has a good plan, a good future for you. What do you think about your future? When Jesus was saying this word, Judas was present. That's how it is. It's not how many conferences, how many sermons, how many lectures. He was privileged to eat with the Lord Jesus Christ. Slept where he slept. And yet at the end, Satan entered into his own heart. And deceiving. There are forces in the world that want to mitigate and fight and hinder those who are struggling. You know, I want to go to heaven. You finish prayer like this, you know, the devil wants to be throwing his arrow. after service. There are so many, many that are finding it so difficult. Even though you have read the Word of God, you know what the Bible says, but are you living in obedience to the Word of God? Judas was there. Judas has the word. He was present, and yet this promise did not save him. He lost his future into this world. We cannot be so careless about our future. You can't worry about many things, and you neglect your own soul. The apostle writing to the believers in the book of 1 Timothy 6, godliness with contentment is a great gain. You brought nothing into this world. When you leave, you will take nothing out. Godliness with contentment. Are you godly? The way you look at things, can you perceive spiritually? Can you, is your life in line with the word of God you've been hearing? You have read it. We thank God, for being in this church for so long. We thank God when we see you, sisters and brothers. But how is your preparation for the kingdom to come? This is not about something you just wishful thinking and say, if I do this, nothing you can do to substitute for this. It needs your obedience, it needs your love, your affection. Set your affections on things from above, not on things from the earth. Lay not up for yourself treasures. Distraction is too much for Christians of today. You want to be like the people of the world? Is that why you are against your pastor every time you come on? Today is holiness, tomorrow is holiness, this and that, and you have something against that. You know, there are some Christians who are living the life of forgiveness. With this promise that you want to be with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, will that change you today? Make you think twice? What is said? Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. The danger we live in concerning faith in the latter day is a perilous time will come. Many will depart from home. They will hear, but it's not like, it's not penetrating, it's not doing good anymore. It's something, you look at it, you trivialize it. Because the seducing spirit are in the world. When the message of holiness is something repulsive to you, and you are looking for a prophet of hell, from the gates of hell, who will tell you mere dreams. What is the dream compared to the word of God? It is nothing that will not stand the test of the time. If you see those who have the largest crowd in Africa, prophet who will step on the pregnant woman's stomach, taking snake to the church, and when you see the crowd, it will amaze you. You wonder whether these people are preparing for heaven, the same heaven that Jesus spoke about. This promise will not miss you.
Amen.
This promise will not miss me.
Amen.
But we got to prepare for it. If we don't want to miss it like Judas, we got to prepare for it. We got to prepare with all our hearts. And that is why when we understand the promiser and we take his word to our hearts, that's the way, is the way, the truth, and the life to this glorious hope. I will be talking about preparation for Christ's return. The promise for Christ's return, the preparation for Christ's return. Let's turn to the book of Matthew chapter 24. And I'm looking at verse 44 through verse 45. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not the Son of Man coming. Look at that word of the Lord. Therefore, be ye also ready, in readiness, in readiness. How is your preparation? For in such an hour that you think not, then it will come. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give him, to give them meat in the due season? Now, there are two ways. I will tell us about how to get prepared. If you have not given your life to Jesus Christ, you've been religious, you've been coming, you're comforting yourself with that. There are some people who will rather give money than to give their lives. They can give a large amount of money for the church and say, oh, you just do the gospel. For me, let me just live my life. Now, what is going to happen? The Lord will reward you here. But if you want to get there, you need to change. You need transformation of life, transformation of heart. So I've been talking about seven things we can do, how to get prepared. Saved, except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Sanctify. Follow peace and holiness with all men, without which no man will see the Lord. There is none that you can ignore. You cannot belittle to any of those. If you are not born again, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It means you are not there yet. I was born into a religious family, CMS, and we go to church, we come back home. Nothing happened until I gave my life to Jesus Christ in 1972. There is a difference between just being an attendee in the church, or you are interested. You know, it's a kind of social gathering. You know, it moved me. I just love to make friends there. But when it comes to accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, have you done that? Did you have the persuasion, the conviction? When did you do it? What happened to you? If any man is in Christ, it's a new creature. All things are passed away. All things become. You know the kind of salvation we don't believe in? That you say you are saved today, tomorrow you are back into your mud. You are doing what the worlds are doing. No change. And some say, you know, this addition, you know, I mean, you know, God understands. And they will smoke and smoke until they die. The grace is available for all sinners to be transformed, to be born again. The grace is also available, His blood is available for your sanctification. For without holiness, it is impossible for anyone to enter into that kingdom. It is impossible for anyone to enter into that kingdom. Number three, spirit feed. In the book of Acts 4:31, the latter part, be filled with the Spirit and not with wine. Be filled with the Spirit and not with wine. Spirit filled. So your life should be filled with the Holy Ghost. Those are the things that God has given, the promise of the Father to His own disciples, so that He will help us prepared. I cannot but to tell you a story of a sister that was having a very serious persecution. And that was 1975. But this sister will run to me and they pray with me in the church. But the persecution was too much. And they crying for her. The family want to force her literally to marry anybody because Jesus is getting too late. What are you doing in that church? You are so old like this, you are a virgin. Huh? You are so old like this, you never know any man. Come on, even if we bundle you and give you to a drunkard. So the brother got himself ready from, you know, already forgotten, Ethiopia, whatever. That's where he lived. He ran and he said, he's going to get her by all means. The sister ran to me in the church and we started praying. As she was crying and praying, the Lord revealed to her the glory we are talking about today by the Holy Ghost. And took her by the hand and said, come and see, I will show you something where you should not give up. And we were still praying together. But when she told me, I was so blessed. She said, oh Lord, let me see that. No, the Lord said, no, the fight is not over. You will still go back and do my will in the world. Though it's tough, persecution is there, you know, I will be with you. He promised to be with us, and he will be with us. Once you are born again, you are sanctified, you are filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, it's more than just speaking a tongue, being filled with the Holy Ghost. He will, you know, grant you, make you rooted in your faith. Desire the Spirit of God. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Be controlled. Number four, be controlled. Be Spirit controlled. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. Romans 8, verse 14. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. And then the fifth one, surrender. Surrender. Present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service. Romans 12, verse 1. Present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service. When you do all this, number six, sacrifice yourself. Because I be the prophet of a man. Gain the whole world and you lose your soul. Sacrifice yourself for the love of Christ. Set your affections on things from above. Believe in the gospel. Be committed. Sacrifice. Jesus sacrificed for you. We like to talk about his crucifixion. What about yours? Apostle Paul said, I am crucified with Jesus Christ. Nevertheless, I live. The life that I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God. So how crucified are you to the things of the world? If you die to the things of the world, it will not move you anymore. Many of us are, you know, trigger happy about, you know, it's when you have money. If the job is not going fine, you know, a woman ran to the church and said, you know, every time, you know, when I come in to pray and we pray more, it's like I'm having warfare at my workplace. I said, that's why you need to pray more. Because the devil hates what you are doing. It's not time to give up because you see persecution. Don't let the things of the world blindfold you about what God wants to do in your life. And number seven, I want to talk about, you know, serve God and man. This is my own alliteration. Serve God and man. I always say, don't be 12 o'clock. God knows my heart. Yeah, God knows your heart. It's your roommate knows your heart. God knows your heart. Have you forgiven? Your roommate can. What influence do you have on your roommate? What influence do you have on your husband? Some people think that God will just overlook all this. Now, whatever you do, doesn't. No, God says, if you don't love the brother you see now, how can you say you love me? You will not have answer. He came down. He looked for us. You know, the will of the Father must be done. He came down. He looked for us. He said, if you are just 12 o'clock, your Christianity is doubtful. You're not touching anybody. You are not shining as light. You are not bearing the fruit that Jesus said, by their fruit, yes, I know them. This is where we need to get the job done. Sacrifice yourself. Serve God and serve man. Serve God and serve human being. Why is it necessary? Because if you don't do that, how are you showing the love of God? How are you showing the love of God to the world? It is important, and I could hear the pastor talking about, and they gave some things out. This is how to lay your treasures in heaven. Your soul saved, and the people you labor for, and they are saved. So when you are going, you are not going empty-handed. On that day, God will look at your labor for him, and he will reward you. God will reward you for your labor, because that is the will of God. You're fulfilling the will of God. You will be rich towards God by doing that. But if you don't do that, Holy Ghost will speak in tongues, and we want to make money, and we see vision, and say, Holy Spirit is moving this morning. If you can touch my garment for 1,000 naira, we will have a group of people, we will just have a crowd. But if you are building the church, they have to enter through the narrow gate. They live the way of the world. It is different. This is different. It's different. They can sweet talk you because they know how to put their words together. And they do some miracle and gimmick and play games. But when it comes to the kingdom of God, pay attention to what the scripture says. Especially you are privileged to be in a church like this, where the Bible, you know, is being taught undiluted, unedited. There is no excuse. Youth that are having questions and you are looking for other things, you know, if all the scientific knowledge is trying to torpedo you from the will of God, think twice. It is very important for you to understand this is totally different thing. If you go to heaven and say, I am Dr. So-and-so, your name is not written. We don't know you. You know, I own this bank. Well, we don't need your bank here. It is your soul that will report. When your soul reports before the Lord, it is time for accountability. Show me what you have done. I give you, you know, this is my purpose for your life. Show me the way you have walked. That's it. That's where mouth sits. A lot of easing, and you know, people feel sorry. Death is a lonely path. I have not died by the grace of God. I'm here. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But you know, God is a good God. One night he revealed to me. I don't know what happened. Something just happened. Boom! I saw somebody die. And I wore my suit, thinking that as normal I'm going to preach. But I was sorrowful. So I held my Bible. As I was doing that, then I looked down. I saw my wife, I saw the congregation, I saw those brothers pushing me. The casket towards me. And the Lord said, you are the one. I said, no. I reject the early death in Jesus' name. Amen. I reject that early death in Jesus' name. Amen. I woke up. I was shocked to my bone. It's so lonely, brethren, that if you want to see my wife, I'm here. They can't hear you. But Raphael is, I'm here. I'm not there. They can't hear you. You cannot touch. You will see them, but you cannot touch anything that belongs to you. You cannot show your wife the secret you hide from her. on your husband. It's over. You do that right now. It is now we make our way plain, and it shall be well with us in Jesus' name. Lastly, they're talking about permanent rest for believers in Christ. Permanent rest for believers in Christ. In the book of Hebrews 9, chapter 4, from verses 9 to 11, I will quickly read because of my time. There remained therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did for his. Let us labor. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into the rest, lest any man fail after the same example of unbelief. The Lord delivered the people of Israel from the land of Egypt. Say, I'm taking them to the promised land. You know, unfortunately, with all the miracle and everything, many of them did not make it. And God, Paul was writing, he said, this is written for our example. We that are alive, that we may learn from that. There is a rest yet that you have not been to. When we are talking about eternity, you have not been there. This is what you have seen. The glory that you have seen in America, or if you go to London, this is what you have seen. But there is something that we don't even have, we don't know how to describe it for you. But the Bible says, the city of God, there is no night, there is no, it's endless, everything. It's a city full of the glory of God. Righteousness reign there. No more crying, no more weeping. If anyone will not be, interested just by reading that or hearing that, and you don't want to give your life to Jesus Christ, if you want to save your life from him, you will lose it. But if you give your life to him, you want to be part. When the road is called yonder, you want to be there. We sang about heaven, lift me up to higher ground. What do you want to do with your life in the valley? Lift me up to the higher ground. Because when the saints of God are marching, your name will also be called, that you will be there. You will not hear the word in vain. I will not preach in vain. If there is anything that we should never miss, it's eternal life. You cannot play with this. Whatever it takes, do everything possible that you will be among the worthy souls. Let us rise up and we'll pray. Let's ask the Lord to help us. This is your time. This is your time. We know we live in a very dangerous world, and the devil is working with greater alacrity, going all around, deceiving. Now, if it were possible, he can deceive the very elect. He that thinketh is standing, let him examine himself. Take precaution, take heed. Is there anything that the Lord has revealed to you, but you still don't want to give it up? For the sake of your future, eternal life, that you don't want to lose your soul, would you surrender to the love of God today? Would you surrender? Give it up. Give yourself. Commit yourself. Nothing else matters when we leave this world, but our soul will depart before Him. We are expecting the second coming of the Lord. When He comes, He will take us home. If you are alive, you'll be transformed to meet with the Lord in the air. If you die, He will raise you up. You will partake in the first resurrection. There are so many dead, and the books were open for the great and the, for the small and the great. For anyone whose name is not written in the book of life will not have part with the Lamb of God. Will not reign with Christ. Will not have eternal rest. Lord, I want to make it. Strengthen me. Give me grace. Touch me. Anything that I need to give up, today help me to do so. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
When the road is all of yonder, when the road is all of yonder, when the road is all of yonder, us not to just you know, show up in the church for program or worship our talent, but to worship you, to dedicate our lives unto you. Whether anyone is there or not, for your sake, we want to give everything that is of the world. Lay our life upon the altar. Serve you to the end. Give that grace to your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, I pray that we see vanity written on everything that is trying to deceive us here.
Amen.
That when we look at it, that is vanity. Vanity upon vanity. May your love fill our hearts that we will love you to the end in Jesus' name.
Amen.
For those who are getting weary and Christianity has becoming a routine, today set their hearts on fire in Jesus' name.
Amen.
May the hunger of God, thirst for righteousness, fill our hearts in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That on our own, we just want to be a willing, living sacrifice. We pray, we fast, we do so many, we give ourselves to the work of the kingdom. Help us, Lord, to be fervent and the zeal of the Lord to come upon everyone in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We want to thank you, Father, and we bless your holy name. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.